you for joining us today. We trust that you will be motivated, challenged, and inspired by this week's message.
Hey, church, how are you? Happy New Year. I can't promise that I'll do any Michael Jackson moves for you today. I'll leave those to Pastor Mike. He's good at them. It's exciting to be here. And thank you so much for your kind words. And I know that you guys are great friends to Lindley and myself. Lindley is my wife, by the way. I have one wife and three kids. One wife is enough wives to have. Three kids is too many. But it's really exciting to be here. I started off the trip over here in the UK by landing on the last Saturday of December, and then preaching three times at Kensington Temple in London for my friend Pastor Colin Dye, and then we had a crazy six-hour service at a church called Trinity Baptist Church in London, and they're all Nigerians and Ghanaians. And the three of us, Audrey and Garrett and myself, were the only white faces in a sea of black faces. So, and it was all online as well. I had to sit in the front row. So every time the camera came across, I think it picked on me. So 6 hours, it was fantastic. It was awesome. But I promise you today that I won't be preaching for 6 hours. So, you know what? I became a Christian in what I would say would have been a very revolutionary period of time in the church worldwide. I got saved when I was 14 years old, and I got saved in 1974. That's a long time. People are doing the maths right now. He's 103. No, bad teaching here in Weston. But no, I got saved in 1974, and I got saved when I was at high school through a Christian group at school, which was fantastic. But the 70s in the church, in the life of the church, was a really revolutionary kind of time, because at that particular point in time, a lot of denominational churches, Anglicans, Baptists, and so on, were getting a move of the Holy Spirit, and things were happening, and people's lives were being transformed and changed. And, you know, music back then, the music in the church was generally, you know, most churches had an organ, a church organ, and a little old lady playing the church organ, and people singing out of time, and all kinds of crazy stuff. And that was even in some of the Pentecostal churches around. Back in the early 1900s, they thought the organ was of the devil. They were right. But I remember our pastor's wife used to play the piano, and she played in this old honky-tonk kind of style, and we were trying to play guitar and drums and bass along with the honky-tonk piano, and it was quite a challenge. But it was a revolutionary time. It was a time when I remember I had a band. I had a Christian band that I was part of, and we used to go around to other churches, and they'd say, "Turn those drums down. Those drums are off the devil. No, we don't want any distortion in that guitar. It's like that's demonic, you know." And we did all kinds of crazy things. People used to actually stand outside of our meetings praying against us. Not that we sounded terrible, but they used to just stand outside praying against us. It was a time to be a revolutionary. And there were people in America who were creating a music revolution in Christian music and so on. And in the church, there was a revolution of thinking. And it was a radical time. And so I grew up in this kind of revolutionary, radical kind of movement of God. But I think in 2014, it's time to have a new revolution. It's time to actually get a little bit radical again. It's time to stir ourselves up out of our conservatism, out of our ordinariness, out of just normality, and start to get revolutionary once again about our Christianity. Because Christianity is worth being revolutionary about. You know, the standard thing these days is not to wear a tie. Yeah. And when you're preaching in church, well, I thought I'd be a revolutionary and wear a tie today. I thought I'd just be a little bit rebellious and wear my tie. Because I want to do something different. I don't want to just do the same old that I've always done. We've got to be radicals again for God. Well, if you have a look at Luke chapter 5, Luke chapter 5, verse 1. Have you got your iPad there or your mini or your iPhone? Or does anybody ever bring a normal Bible to church anymore? Yes! Praise God. Who's got a normal Bible? Hold it up in the air. Actually, you see, these Bibles, these normal Bibles are so rare. When I went to the Baptist church, somebody stole my Bible. I can't find it. So this is what it says. This is from the Message version. It says, once when he was standing on the shore of the Lake Gennesaret, the crowd was pushing in on him to better hear the word of God. He noticed two boats tied up. The fishermen had just left them and were out scrubbing their nets. He climbed into the boat that was Simon's and asked him to put out a little from the shore. Sitting there, using the boat for a pulpit, he taught the crowd. When he finished teaching, he said to Simon, push out into deep water and let your nets out for a catch. Simon said, Master, we've been fishing hard all night and haven't even caught a minnow. But if you say so, I'll let out the nets. It was no sooner said than done. A huge haul of fish, straining the nets past capacity. They waved to their partners in the other boats to come help them. They filled both boats, nearly swamping them with the catch. Simon Peter, when he saw it, fell to his knees before Jesus. Master, leave. I am a servant and can't handle this holiness. Leave me to myself. When they pulled in that catch of fish, awe overwhelmed Simon and everyone with him. It was the same with James and John, Zebedee's sons, co-workers with Simon. Jesus said to Simon, there is nothing to fear. From now on, you'll be fishing for men and women. They pulled their boats up on the beach, left them, nets and all, and followed him. Amen. And followed him. Fantastic. You know, Jesus wasn't talking about following him on Twitter. Or Facebook. He was talking about literally following him. Following in his footsteps, doing what he did. Listening to what he said and taking part in everything about the kingdom of God. And we see in another version of this story in Matthew, this is what he says in Matthew chapter 4, verse 19. He says, follow me and I will make you become fishers of men. I will make you. You know, it's not what we do for God that really counts. It's not what we do. You could do all kinds of amazing works, all kinds of incredible stuff for God. It's not what we do. It's who we're becoming that really, really counts. You see, God is more interested not in the little works that we might be involved in or do, but he's interested in making us into somebody. Amen? He's interested in molding us and changing us and transforming us so that we will grow up on the inside. Follow me and I will make you. It's not like God wants to make you. You know, like a teacher might make a student. It's not like he's going to force you, but he wants to do something and mold you and change you and do something with you on the inside. It's not so much about trying to behave better or be a better person or even, you know, try to, you know, we all have New Year's resolutions, I guess. Maybe you've you're not bothered about it this year. Because you know every year you make a New Year's resolution, yeah, I'm going to do more exercise. I'm going to look like Pastor Mike. I hate Pastor Mike so much because on Facebook he's put all this stuff about how fit he is and how far he's run. I'm going, I hate you. I don't really. But it's like, you know, it's not about trying to change yourself. It's not about trying to stop this or stop that or do this and not do that. It's about allowing God to do something. Allowing God to actually make you. He put you together. He designed you. He gave you the crazy personality that you have. Certainly gave me my crazy personality. That's my excuse anyway. You know, the Bible says in James chapter 1, verse 17, every good and perfect gift comes from above, from the Father of lights, in whom there's no variation or shadow of turning. In other words, when God designed you and made you and created you, He created you for a purpose. He gave you gifts, and He's not going to take those gifts back. No matter what you do, no matter if you fell away from God, you'd still have those gifts. But you know, He designed you and made you for a great purpose, and a greater purpose sometimes than you even think. What does it take to make something? You know, I watched, when I was flying over here, I watched the movie about Steve Jobs. Really, really cool movie. What a meanie he was. He's so mean to everyone. But at the same time as being mean, he knew how to get things done. And he knew how to create something. And, you know, he created basically what is now the most valuable company in the world. And many, many people are like, we're using his products now today for church. And I thought, what does it take to make something? It takes time. It takes innovation and creativity. It takes all the components or the ingredients to be in the right place at the right time. It takes the right personnel, the skill to make something. And it takes determination. I mean, Steve Jobs was so determined to be excellent in everything that he did, to make a product that would be an excellent product. And maybe it even takes a 3D printer. I don't know. But what does God want to make us? What does He want to make us? What does He want to make you in 2014? Maybe 2013 was a good year for you. Maybe for some of you it wasn't such a good year. Maybe you feel like in 2013 you felt frustrated by things. Maybe you feel like you just want something fresh to happen to you. Well, this is a great opportunity right now at the beginning of a new year to see something fresh happen for you. So what does God want to make us? I believe this. Number one, He wants to make us fruitful in every area of life, especially in evangelism. So what's fruitfulness? If He wants to make us fruitful, you know, I don't know if you've ever seen a fruit tree going, oh, to make the fruit. I won't do that again. I don't know if you've ever seen a fruit tree straining and struggling to make fruit. No, a fruit tree doesn't strain and struggle to make the fruit. I mean, I, as a little kid, I used to think fruit just came from the supermarket. That's how non-country I was, how citified I was. But a tree doesn't struggle and strain to make fruit, but fruit will come naturally and without effort when there's good soil, when that soil is watered. If you want to be a fruitful Christian, then you ought to get planted somewhere, planted in the house of God. And those who are planted in the house of God, they are going to flourish. They are going to be fruitful. If you are planted with your roots deep down, it's like, you know, if you want to be a fruit tree and you want to be planted and you want to be fruitful in your life, then you don't see trees, you know, uprooting themselves and going to another orchard because they think it's a nicer and a better orchard. I just might get my little their roots uproot themselves and no, I've never seen a tree do that. Trees stay where they are. Trees planted in one place become fruitful if they're planted in good soil. You know, sometimes there's places that are not good soil. Sometimes there's not much watering going on because there's neglect. But I want to tell you, this is a church where it's good soil. This is a church where you can be planted. This is a church where you'll receive watering. What's this watering? This is like the Word of God. This is the Word of God soaking into us so that we have life and life abundantly. You can't be fruitful being an itinerant tree. Come on. You've got to be planted to be fruitful. God wants to make you fruitful in every avenue of your life, in your family life, in your workplace, in your business life, in the community, and in your witness to other people. It's really interesting. This year, 18 months ago, I went back and started teaching back at high school. And I still travel and do ministry stuff as well. But I felt like I wanted to kind of be home a little bit more with the family. And also, I was a teacher many, many years ago and taught for 7 or 8 years before I became a pastor full time. And I thought, well, you know, the Apostle Paul, he had a business in Ephesus. He had a business in different places that he went to. And he had a job. He had work. and I just felt for myself, it's not for every minister or every pastor to do this, but I felt for myself it would be a good thing to be back school teaching. And so I'm back at school, and it's hilarious. It's great. It's fantastic. I love it. The kids are fun, and they're high school kids, so they're a little bit cheeky and everything. But, you know, it's so, so good. And I get the opportunity. I'm working with people that, you know, people that don't think the same way as me at all. People who are New Age thinkers and people who, you know, people with different thoughts about, you know, sexual orientation and all kinds of things. And they are working with all these people. But I love them all, and it's fantastic. And maybe some of them don't love me all that much, but some of them love me. I'm sure they do. They're nice people, but they need Jesus. And I thought about this. I thought, wow, this is like, what did Jesus use? What did Jesus use to win this crowd of people when he went down to the lake? He was standing at the side of the lake, and the crowd was so big, it must have been a massive crowd kind of pushing him into the water. They just said, well, I need to get on these boats. And he got on one of the boats, and he was sitting there on the boat teaching. It's interesting, apparently the viscosity of the water is such that it's actually a reflective surface. So his voice would have been amplified because of the water, first PA system. And so Jesus was there teaching from the boat. What was he using? He was using Peter's workplace as his pulpit. You know, some of us, we don't like our jobs. You know, there's things about my job that I don't like. There's always something about your job that you don't like. And some of us go, well, you know, why am I here? I wish I could just be, you know, a preacher like Pastor Mike and preaching in the pulpit. That would be my calling, you know. Now, for some people, that is their calling. But I reckon Jesus wants to use your workplace as his pulpit. I don't mean that you have to stand up on your desk and preach at people. But do you know what I'm saying? They know that you're a Christian already. They know that you love the Lord. They will come to you and ask questions. My direct boss, who's lovely, she's really lovely. She's sort of into New Age, and she's done Reiki healing and all these kinds of weird and wonderful things and everything. She sits down at the table with me for coffee at this coffee shop we go to, and she says, "Oh, David, you know, I know about the Father and the Son because I grew up in the church, and you know, but I don't really know about the Holy Spirit. Can you tell me about the Holy Spirit?" People will ask you questions. People will approach you. So God wants to use you in your workplace. He wants to use you amongst your family. You don't have to Bible bash people. You just have to be who you are in God. Be nice. Be nice. Hello? Just be nice. Don't be a meanie at work. God can use what you are doing now for His glory. Second thing is, He wants to make us significant in eternity. He wants to make us all significant in eternity. You know, followers are just normal people. I'm normal. No, truly. Ordinary people. God delights in taking the ordinary and doing something extraordinary. When I was a teenager, before I got saved, I was like the nerdiest nerd of all nerds. I was so totally nerdy. I was the ultimate nerd. I'd hide in the library at lunchtime. I would just, you know, I was so afraid of other people. I was so afraid of speaking publicly. I was so nervous. I was so self-conscious. And, you know, I was born here in the UK, and my parents immigrated to Australia when I was 5 years old. And so I felt so different from every other kid. My mother even exaggerated that a little bit because she knit me a school jumper that was totally different to everybody else's school jumper. I want my son to be an individual. And you know, as a, when you put a kid in a jumper that nobody else is wearing at school, they feel like about this big. I'm not blaming my mum. Sorry, mum, if you're watching this. But you know, I felt so different. I was so insecure that somebody would look at me, you know, and I think they were laughing at me. They probably were, but like, I was even insecure when I first started going to church. You know, when I first started going to Hillsong Church, I thought Pastor Brian hated me. That's how insecure I was. Now I know he hates me. It's okay. I thought Darlene didn't like me, and or Jeff Bullock, there, any of those people that were leaders in the early days of our church. I thought, oh, they don't really like me. The funny thing is they asked me to sing every week in church. I was still so insecure. Sometimes we carry over things into our lives from our childhood that we still struggle with. And sometimes I still struggle with that. But I want to tell you, God has the victory in my life. So I don't need to struggle with that. I can be secure, not because of who I am, but because of who He is in me. So if you feel insecure, if you feel like you are, you have something that you struggle with in your life, God's on your side, man. He's on your side. We're just normal people. God calls ordinary people and does extraordinary things with them. I've been blessed to have been able to travel around the world preaching and singing and doing all kinds of things and helping churches and leaders and worship teams and evangelizing and so on. And over the last 10 years, I've seen something like 50,000 people make decisions to follow Christ. I feel like, well, I'm just an ordinary guy. I'm no one special. But in God, we're all special. You're the apple of his eye. You are loved by God. It doesn't matter whether you've been to church or do this or do that. Whatever you do and whatever you've done, God still loves you. God cares about you. God wants to see you do something significant. You know, significance is not about fame. It's not about fortune. Significance is about doing the thing that you're designed to do. How are you wired up? How are you designed? That's significance is about you achieving some of those goals, some of those things that are there for you to achieve in your life. Significance is not about trying to be like somebody else or be another person or live another person's life. I mean, we look at people online and so on in the world who are famous, like Justin Bieber or this person or that person. We think, that's really significant. No, that's significant for him. What Michael Jackson did was significant for him. But what you are designed to do is significant for you. Reaching what God has for you. There was a man who nobody knows who was preaching away one day in a church. A young boy came down and gave his life at the altar. That young boy's name was Billy Graham. You see, the man might have preached to a few people. It only took him one salvation to see something significant. See, you never know who you're going to influence. You never know. You might think, I'm not, this and I'm not that, and I couldn't do this and I couldn't do that, and I'm not, I can't speak very well or this. It's not about that. It's just about being who you are. It's about allowing God to make you who you are meant to be. He can make you significant. He can make you into a person who can do something and see something significant happen, which is exciting. The third thing is this. He wants to make us effective now. See, the call of God begins now. He said, Peter, I need your boat. Like I said before, Peter's boat was his job, his vocation. He turned the boat into a pulpit. Wherever you are and whatever you're doing now is Jesus' pulpit. Many people are waiting for ministry when it's right in front of them. It's just right there. Oh, I'm waiting for something really important to happen. Sometimes I know some people, they're waiting for an important person to come along to talk to. Well, maybe the important person's sitting right in front of you. Hello? Everyone's important. Hello? Everyone's important to God. Just because someone does this or does that doesn't make them any more important than anybody else. Everyone's important to God. You never know who you're talking to. Some people who are just, out on the street people, you never know, one of them could be a millionaire. See, some of us don't like what we're doing now. We're frustrated. But wherever God's put you now, he's put you there for a reason. Maybe that reason's one person. Maybe that reason's one person. Fourth thing is this. He wants to make us kings and priests who rule and reign in this life. Hebrews proclaims that we're kings and priests. So what does it mean to be a king? To be a king means to be the head and not the tail. Sometimes we act like we're the tail as Christians. We act like, I'll just sit back and... We've got to realize that we can be the head and not the tail. I was reading about the blessing of Abraham the other day. And that's what it says in Genesis. He said, I want to make you the head and not the tail, above and not beneath. Expect an upgrade. Expect an upgrade. Expect to be, you know, first in line. People in England love queuing. They love queuing. I was standing in a shop one day, and I was just standing there, and people started to queue behind me. And I was just standing there, and I walked away. I was laughing so much. But you know what? He wants you to rule and reign in your life. Whatever comes against you, whatever is just trying to cut you down and pull you down, he wants to build you up and not cut you down. And you can rule over your circumstances. You know what? Sometimes people pray and they pray very immature prayers. Oh, God, take this away from me. Take this thing away from me. No, God doesn't want to take stuff away from you. Hello? He wants you to jump over it. We can jump over a wall and leap over the top of our problems or run through them. I don't know, have you ever seen like a battle scene in one of those type of movies where you know, the hero is there with the sword and they just run through the middle of the crowd of people and they're all, you know, swords and everything everywhere. I like that picture because I see that's us. It's like we got the sword in our hand, which is the word of God. We got the full armor of God on. We can run through a troop and leap over that wall. You can defeat the enemy. Oh, but a pastor has to pray for me. No, you can pray for yourself. You got a mouth. You got your own brain. You don't. It's nice to have other people pray for you. It's nice to have the pastor pray for you. But you can do it for yourself. You can overcome all of these things very quickly. The last thing is this. God wants to make us strategic thinkers and doers. Don't stop listening to God. After the message that Jesus gave, he didn't finish preaching. He went on to talk to Peter on his own. It's after we decide to follow Jesus that he'll give us the strategy. Many Christians are trying to follow themselves and their own strategies, you know. Oh, I think that'd be a really good idea if we did blah, 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 blah. No, don't just look for a good idea. I tell people all the time, I say, there's always opportunities that are going to come your way, but not every opportunity is a good one. Not every opportunity is a God opportunity. There are good opportunities out there, but we've got to get a word from God. We've got to seek God. We sometimes now we just go, oh yeah, whatever, we'll just do whatever. And sometimes when you do the whatever, you'll find yourself frustrated or beating your head against a brick wall because it didn't quite work out. Well, I would rather wait on the Lord. I don't mean I have to wait for hours or, you know, whatever, but like I'd rather wait on the Lord for his word, his direction, his plan and his purpose. Because when we just do our own thing, it's like Jesus said, Father, not my will be done. If it's good enough for Jesus to say that, it's good enough for you and me to say that. Father, not my will be done, but your will be done. What is the will of God for your life? Well, the will of God's quite obvious. It's not like to buy an iPad, but it's like, well, maybe it is, I don't know. But the will of God is found in the Word of God. The plan of God is found in the Bible. You can know the plan of God by just reading the Bible. It's really plain and obvious and simple, but it's so complicated sometimes. You know what I'm saying? But God wants to speak to you. The Bible says he speaks with a still small voice. He doesn't come in the thunder and the lightning and the many waters, the loud sounds. He speaks with a still small voice. You know, if you hear something speaking to you, the voice of your conscience about something, which is the voice of God, by the way, then listen to it. If it's contrary to what the Bible says, then it's not the right voice. But some people take the Bible and they take a text out of context and they go, oh yes, Judas hung himself. Go and do you likewise. That's not the way to get direction from the Bible. You have to take the text in the context of the time and the era that it was written in and all the other things and study it so that you can show yourself approved. A workman rightly dividing the word of truth. So to finish up today, this is what we need for a new revolution. What's the key to being made by God? I tell you, it's one thing. This is a one-point sermon. Lots of people have three-point sermons. This is a one-point sermon. Obey. Will I say it again? Obey. That's what it is. The key to all of this is obedience. To obey, the Bible says, is better than sacrifice. To be made by God and molded by God means we just say yes to God. Say yes to God. I want to encourage you in 2014 to say yes to God. Don't follow your own plans. Don't follow just your every opportunity that's presented to you. Find out what God wants for you individually. Find out what God wants for you corporately. And I know that God has plans for this church. God has a purpose for this church. God has a purpose for you being here in Weston. And He has a purpose for you as part of this house of God. The greatest purpose you can join yourself to is the purpose of the kingdom of God. And if you're here today and you've never consciously made a decision to be a follower of Jesus, then today is your day. It's not a mistake that you came here to the church service today. Perhaps everybody here has already done this before, but maybe you've never done this. Or maybe you did it a long time ago and you feel like you're far, far, far away from God. But today is your day. Not going to embarrass you or anything like that, but I'd love to have the opportunity of praying with you to receive Jesus today. Or coming back to God. As He's calling you home in Jesus' name. Would you just close your eyes with me? Every person in this place today, God loves you. He's called you and set you apart for His purposes. Everyone else is going to join in and pray with us. So let's pray together. Dear Lord Jesus, I come to you right now. I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I give you everything. I don't want to walk my own way anymore. I want to walk your way. I want to live for you. In Jesus' name. Forgive me, Lord. And I know you will. I give you my life now. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
We hope you have enjoyed today's message. To download further resources, click on the resources icon. If this message has impacted your life, we would love to hear from you. So don't forget to join us next week for another inspiring message.